Welcome to the Russ Meeks Speak Show. This is a community forum that explores important topics in the areas of culture, politics, and education that are relevant in the world today. I am Dr. Ulwyn Pierre, and I am the host of the show today. I am an international consultant, and I am a leadership breakthrough and transformational specialist, and I work with leaders from around the world in helping transform their lives and their businesses. We have a very special guest with us today, Dr. Brandon Hamilton. He's a very interesting person. We met him months ago, and he has had an international impact, not only on businesses and people, but also on changing their lives. And then another interesting area that he deals with is the area of developing boards. And today, this is the area that we are going to focus on, the art and strategy of developing boards.
Glad to be here.
Mm-hmm. Great to have you here. Mm-hmm. Welcome. Now, I would like you to speak a little bit about you. You have an interesting career, and I would like our listeners to be able to learn from some of your experiences and the kinds. I want you to stress also what made you move from one career to another.
All right. Interesting question, Dr. Pierre. I am a native of Chicago, actually. I was born in Bronzeville. The listeners might know Bronzeville to be a rich community back then of blues and art. So my family was part of that community. However, I grew up in Gary, Indiana. My mother moved us to Gary, Indiana, and so many people also probably know the history of Gary, Indiana. I grew up there, but didn't want to be defined by just those two zip codes. I really was intrigued when I would meet people from other places. So I traveled. I jokingly tell people I was a college drop-in, not a drop-out. I just started going to colleges. So I studied in Boston, I studied in Washington, D.C., I studied in Los Angeles, et cetera, et cetera. So I have 5 college degrees, and one in art, one in engineering, one in business, and one in information systems, and then finally a doctorate in business. So before I got that doctorate in business, I was an engineer for years, but I was intrigued about management. So I got involved with launching space shuttles. I was working with TRW, NASA, and aerospace, and a company called GenCorp to put a satellite in space. So that was my first taste of
wonderful
management.
And what influenced you to get into that area?
Engineering or management?
Management and engineering, and then being a part of the space shuttle.
Well, yeah, you did ask about all the career changes, and yeah. I really need to answer that properly for you. I was not sure of what I wanted to do with myself, and it was sort of an understanding that if you had an engineering degree, you could probably be employed. Mm-hmm. And I was good in math, so I figured I might as well just get good in physics, and then I could be an engineer. And that was it. That was it. I had no sense of what engineering was. Okay. I learned along the way. Mm-hmm. So it was being employed.
Okay. So but I guess when people say you put one foot in front of the other and then you just move on, rings true for you?
Yes. I was a kind of person that knew that any life that I wanted to create for myself, I had to do it for myself, and had an understanding, at least, like many people, that education was a part of that. Okay. And the engineering degree just seemed to make sense. I talked to a number of folks at different colleges who suggested that engineering would be less risky. Mm-hmm. I would probably get a job. The management direction that I took in California was a surprise. I think the motivation was just living in or having a nicer office, you know, living in Mahogany Row instead right of in the trailers, and the salaries, you know. It was an attractive adjustment to mm-hmm. the life I had as an engineer, and I got into whatever it took to be a good manager.
Okay. Now, what are some of the, before we move into the topic of developing boards, okay, what are some of the advice you will give to our listeners, because many people now are looking for jobs? What are 3 key things that they must have in mind and be focused on in order to identify the career paths that they are taking?
Well, Dr. Olin, that's a tough one in today's economy. I understand clearly that so many people are confused about what to do. Mm-hmm. What I learned and what I would suggest to the listening audience as well is you study industries. It should be no surprise to people that healthcare is a thriving industry. Mm-hmm. There are various other industries that are healthy. So even though I was an engineer back in those earlier days, I was also focused on industries. So at that time, it was utilities. I was at a nuclear power plant mm-hmm. in San Diego, not because I had this undying love for public utilities. I just knew that they were looking for folks down there. The utility rates were high, and I wanted to be employed. Mm-hmm. But I would suggest that right from the beginning, to become that kind of a person that gets a degree that is tapped into a need area of an industry that appears to be in growth. And, mm-hmm. and with the Affordable Care Act and various other things related to healthcare, mm-hmm. that should be one option. The other is study the university that you attend. Mm-hmm. Every university has a reputation for students just not graduating, mm-hmm. but getting a job. So find out.
Okay.
Ask some of the students, okay. you know, who went there, what was that experience like? Okay. You know, there's nothing like asking.
Okay.
You know, especially if you're first generation. I was first generation college. No one in my family went to college. My father was an artist, a culinary artist. You know, my mom was a stay-home mom. So it was a journey all the way for me.
So what you're suggesting is that you ask, but you keep on asking until you get the kind of guidance that you want.
That's right.
Okay.
Just yesterday I was asking.
Okay.
You keep asking.
Yes. Now you, when I spoke with you, you shared that you worked with the Carter administration and now you're a professor at DeVry University and got involved in developing boards.
Yes.
Okay. When you talk about developing a board of directors, why is that important?
Oh, I love that question. Why is that important? Yeah, I saw it briefly when I was on the Hill, on Capitol Hill, working under President Carter. I wasn't directly under President Carter. He had a think tank mm-hmm. that was put together from the RAND Corporation. RAND Corporation is a think tank in Santa Monica, California. So there were about 200 of us that were asked to be on the Hill. And I was working there with public policy and strategic policies. So, you know, I had to read the papers. I had to learn mm-hmm. what was happening in Afghanistan. I had to learn what our issues were with China, et cetera. And that was quite a challenge for me, but an interesting challenge, especially that I hadn't been exposed. Well, I started to see, and I really give the credit to that president, I started to see that every leader needs someone to advise them, you know, and he had this team of people. He's an engineer, as you know, so he wanted a group of mm-hmm. people to advise him. So by the time I got to California and I got my master's in business from the University of Southern California, my professors were also suggesting that a board position would be the next move in my career development. Now, it was an executive board MBA program, which means everybody in there was getting their master's in business mm-hmm. to be a vice president or mm-hmm. a president. Okay, so my goal was to be a president. But part of that was a resume building exercise mm-hmm. of joining a board. And I learned then, to answer your question, that a board is the vision for the company. You're not in the day-to-dayness mm-hmm. of the company, but you are extremely aware of all of the stakeholders that can affect the future of that mm-hmm. particular company. So depending on the age of the board and the growth of the board, you want to see that value and you want to see how you value that board when you get on there.
But what does it serve? What's the benefit to the company having a board of directors?
Well, you need advisors. You need management advisors. I felt very lonely when I was a CEO of a film company. When I graduated from University of Southern California, I was the president of a film mm-hmm. company, and I had a couple of vice presidents, but no board. That was a lonely mm-hmm. feeling, you know. And there's a perception that you know everything because you're the president. So boards have various roles depending on the board. The mm-hmm. boards can have a fiduciary financial goal. Boards can be very strategic. In that particular case, I needed someone on that board that I got in that was aware of the arts. I was new to the arts. Mm-hmm. And so I got someone on the board that could make me more aware of the board. So the board takes on the very challenging goals mm-hmm. of the life of that organization. You know, and organizations have a life cycle.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I just as you said, organizations have life cycles. Boards have life cycles. And what is the cycle, the life cycle of a board?
Life cycles of businesses, maybe the audience understands, are simple. A business goes through introduction. It then goes into growth stage. If all goes well and profits come as you want, then you're in mature stage and you need to make some quick decisions or you're going to decline.
Okay.
Well, boards have about 5 stages, all right? And I don't claim ownership for this diagram that I'm showing.
Okay.
It was a friend of mine, a mentor of mine named Dr. Larry Greiner. When he was skiing in Switzerland, he developed these 5 stages. So, you know, the audience can see him on the board. It looks at businesses and your board as being very creative at first, but then they go through a crisis of leadership. And if they don't fix that crisis, then they're in trouble already. They've mm-hmm. collapsed. But if they do, then they go through growth through direction. And the direction then is established by the mission statement and mm-hmm. policies, procedures, all of that mm-hmm. nutsy boltsy stuff for boards. But then you go through a crisis of autonomy. You start to put committees together and various vice presidents together. And sometimes, since you don't see them on a regular basis, they are not under your radar, and okay. they go off half-cocked sometimes, and you need to rein it back in, you know. So there's some myopsies there that need to be adjusted. So, you know, as I showed earlier, there are 5 stages. I don't want to really go through these detailed mm-hmm. stages here, but, you know, perhaps after the show, if audiences want to talk to me, I'm free to share some more details about that.
Okay.
But that's the life.
Okay. I want to get into some more of the nuts and bolts.
Okay.
Okay.
You're an engineer too then.
Strategist.
Oh.
Strategist.
All right. Nuts and bolts strategies. Okay.
Who determines the roles and responsibilities for the board?
Oh, my goodness. Another excellent question. You ask great questions. I like that question too. I wouldn't have been able to answer that at first until I became chair. When I was chair, I determined the roles. What happened is I started to realize that boards and people that manage on the board level know what to do. When I was just a CEO, I knew how to do. But the what to do part, somebody on that board has to have some vision. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, how I ended up being voted chair after 3 months. They mm-hmm. saw me as visionary. I was chairman of an art board, and it was right in the period of time when funding for the arts was down.
Mm-hmm.
The economy was bad, so people weren't, discretionary spending was down, you know, but we couldn't let that mm-hmm. deter the board. I couldn't let that deter mm-hmm. the board. So I moved ticket sales from $6 up to $35. Through some very focused fundraising, grant writing, very targeted grant writing, and other issues that had to do with determining the talent.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some simple basic talents, I think, that have to do with finances and legal. You know, you really should have a lawyer on your board, but mm-hmm. if not, you know, then you need to be able to outsource to a lawyer that you're responsible for. But a leader like me, you know, somebody that is the helm, that is looking at the store every day and going to sleep thinking about the store every day. And so in that thought process, sometimes a new talent comes up, a new need comes up, and you have to present that to the board, of course, if you have a Democratic board, and hopefully they agree with you, and then you get that talent. Okay.
You know, there's a thinking that many boards are inefficient because when people are chosen for being on the board, they're chosen based on who they know versus what they know. And therefore, what would you suggest in terms of when you as a CEO building a board
yes.
and identifying the kind of people that you want to be on your board so
yes.
that they are effective and they serve your organization? What are some of the kinds of things that you would look for the kinds of people that you would want to be very effective on your board.
Yeah, that's an interesting challenge too. It's a straight talk. I've had to ask some people off boards because they were there because they wanted their name mm-hmm. on the letterhead. They wanted to be able to go back to whatever their job was and say that they were a member of the board. Resume building, again, a board has a purpose. It has a goal. It has a heartbeat. It has a mind of sorts that is driving the company where it should be. And so I would solicit from my board members occasionally at meetings, what is the mission of our board? You know, and the mission of the board could be different from the mm-hmm. mission of the company. I didn't let them off the hook just because they knew the mission mm-hmm. of the company. I'd say, well, what is the mission of the board? Sometimes it's fundraising, sometimes it's developing itself, mm-hmm. you know, et cetera. But I would engage them in that in a meeting. You know, when you come to a board meeting, you need to come having done your homework. You need to share with me. I can't keep up with everything as the chair. So there may be some issues out there. There might be a law that's being mm-hmm. written that's going to affect us down the road. There may be a particular client that you know is maybe going to sue us. You know, I'd like to know that. Or there's a new foundation that is loaded up with grants that we need to be about. So you want a board. I thought about this a little bit last night as I was crafting a letter to one of the boards I manage now about the knowledge base of the board. What do I want that to be? The boards themselves can be constructed in such a way that the succession is so easy. When you bring the next person on, they fit right into a nice pair of shoes, okay. You know, so.
But that's because you have clearly identified, you as the CEO of your company and the board, you have clearly identified the kind of people you need, the skill sets you need, and the experience you need, and their commitment.
Absolutely, and commitment. I'm glad you put the C word in there. You brought up something else that's rather interesting too. I've been on boards where I refused to be the CEO.
Okay.
I wanted to be separated from the day-to-day decision making. And I've been on boards where it was effective to be a CEO also mm-hmm. on the board. So there was no loss in translation. Mm-hmm. When the board decided something, it was no loss. When it was brought down to the other officers, it was clear because it came from a board member / CEO. But most of the boards that I've been most effective in, there's a separation of that. And you're right, yeah, someone is the captain of the ship.
Okay.
And they got the helm, and they can be adjusted. You know, I was not a very authoritative, top-down type manager. I was very bottom-up, very empowered, if mm-hmm. you will, Ed Lawler kind of management to bring a scholar in. I was that kind of a person. I used to listen as well as tell. Okay.
So I want to get this clear. Do you believe that it's better for the CEO of a company to be also the CEO of a board, or you find it is better for the CEO of the company to play a separate role and have the CEO of a CEO of a board?
Yeah. Well,
which
president of a board.
Or president of a board.
Yeah,
yes.
President of a board, and then, you know, is that president also the CEO mm-hmm. of the company?
Which you one know, is better?
I wish I could answer that. That's not a simple question or a simple answer. It depends on the characteristics and the resume of the board members mm-hmm. because board members bring value
okay.
to your board, each and every one of them. And so there may be a situation where there's someone that you want to run the board and they are the CEO. Prime example is Michael Dell. Mm-hmm. You know, when Michael Dell started Dell Computer Company, he also became chair mm-hmm. of the board. And then at one point he separated it, mm-hmm. where he was not CEO in his own company. He was strictly running the board, and Dell lost their way.
Mm-hmm.
So he wanted to come back and assume both roles for a while to kind of get it together. Mm-hmm. One of the consulting projects I was on, I ended up advising one CEO, I'm sorry, mm-hmm. to get on the board strictly to get him out of the day-to-day operations of the business. So there's some odd decisions that go either way, actually,
yes.
to your question. But it's based very much on the characteristics mm-hmm. of the people. Every board member comes with resume. And you need to learn that. When I was first brought to a board, I was introduced. The whole meeting was about me. And they interviewed me and they interrogated me and they asked me questions about the industry and what ideas that I have for the industry and like that. I loved it. That was good. That mm-hmm. was proper.
Yes.
And so then when I took over the board, I did the same
okay.
thing. If you come here and you have your name on my letterhead, then you need to bring value to that board. And so, yeah, I think that the decisions that you make as far as roles on that board can be as creative as the boards that you're on.
Okay.
That's why I like your title, The Art of Developing a Board. It's every bit of a science as it is an art.
Yes. Many people think that large companies need boards of directors.
Yeah.
But they don't see as a small business owner or as a business owner, they need a board.
Yeah.
Do you believe as a business owner, it's critical to have a board?
Yes, I do. I'm interviewing for a board position right now to a gentleman, entrepreneur. He must have 3 employees, mm-hmm. very, very small yet to come break out. Mm-hmm. However, he needs that advice. This is a person that's mm-hmm. very, very creative, but there's so much that he doesn't know mm-hmm. about a business that it's great to have me on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
However, he has not been able to develop funds yet to afford me. So mm-hmm. it's an interview,
yes.
You know, we're still going through that. But I admire the fact that he sees that. I read business plans for hobbies.
Okay.
I read annual reports for hobbies.
Okay.
I read Securities and Exchange Commission reports for hobbies. And it's interesting when you read those, because it's particular in business plans that I've been allowed to review, that you will see board positions established for management,
mm-hmm.
for accounting, for legal. You know, you'll do all the other things. You know, let's say that your business is a car wash. You know, it could be as simple as a car wash. And you say, well, I don't need all that. I just need somebody that understands how to wash cars. But I've seen car wash businesses that had a management consultant, had a board member that was a lawyer, and a board member that's an accountant.
Okay.
You need a board, or at least a brain trust, or at least an advisor, to use a new term, throughout your start. Now, you understand when I say advisor, they may not be a permanent board, but you bring them on when you need them and mm-hmm. pay them, of course, and then away when you don't,
mm-hmm.
okay?
So what's the difference between the advisory board and a board of directors, and which one should they begin with? Because normally businesses and entrepreneurs, they have challenges with money.
That's right.
So
that's right.
Share with me, what's the best decision making in terms of how this will progress?
How that works?
Uh-huh.
Yes, I think the advisor is what I would like to say is a good one to start with, mm-hmm. unless you're heavily funded. You know, I mean, I don't accept that I'm a small business and I don't have money.
Mm-hmm.
When you start to study a lot of startups, the ones that I'm very impressed with start off with about 80% of other money.
Mm-hmm.
We call OPM.
Other people's money.
And that's the way it should be. Mm-hmm. You know, if it's value there, you can have investors, mm-hmm. and now you can start with how much money you need,
mm-hmm.
okay? So then you could put whatever board together you need. And I talk to clients about that all the time. However, you're right. The statistics point the other way, that a lot of folks mm-hmm. are underfunded and they need help. So I say to those businesses, then have an advisor. Have them come in for the need,
mm-hmm.
but pay them, please, you know, mm-hmm. really see the value that they're there. Now, nonprofit boards, that's a little different. Nonprofits are a little different.
How are they different?
Well, a board that's nonprofit has a service goal.
Okay.
And so you are really resume building when you're putting that board together. Certain people have good Rolodexes.
Mm-hmm.
Some people know the best ways to get into the golf course. I mean, there are various reasons why I have put people on boards that could be that crazy. But whatever the case, right, you are having a service goal. You're thinking more of the service to your community, service to your church, service to your government, you know, all of those.
Funding.
I've served all those. But
and funding also.
Well, the funding then is the next part of that is what I was going to say, that in those boards, you need to address the funding challenges so that you can pay mm-hmm. those board members. I was on an extremely impressive board once where all the board members were making 6 figures, and it was a nonprofit board. But we were very, very frugal. We were raising over $1 million a day, some days 20 million. You know, the flow of cash in and out of that board was pretty intense.
Mm-hmm.
And the board members earned every bit of that. You know, I mean, I knew one of the board mm-hmm. members that was in the plane all the time. I always talked to him in his plane. And that was fine. As long as he was making things happen, he could stay in his plane all day long, right, as far as I'm concerned. So really, I know sometimes a lot of people feel that if it's a nonprofit board, don't expect to be paid. That's what you typically get. However, I don't agree with that. This is my opinion now. Okay. I don't agree with that. I do think that it's budget driven. So I actually was a chair of a board where I needed some people on my board that we couldn't have gotten if we didn't make them an offer. They were CPA types and lawyer types, et cetera. And so I put a challenge out there to the board that we needed to write a grant or do something so that we can afford these particular persons. And the board agreed, we did it, and then we moved up a notch or two in what capabilities we had. It's about capability building.
Okay.
You're right. If you sit in on municipal boards, you hear that word all the time. Capacity building, capacity building, capacity building. It's about resources. Resources are human, time, and money.
Okay. Concerning resources, when an entrepreneur or business owner is thinking about what are some key people that I must have on my board, what are three key people that each person should have on his or her board?
People or characteristics?
Characteristics.
Okay. Yeah, because people is pretty straightforward. You need a president and a treasurer for legal, and then you could put almost anybody after that.
Characteristics.
But characteristics, top of my list is ethical.
Okay.
I have no patience for someone I can't trust. The board needs to be trustworthy, they're, especially if you're managing a lot of money. You really, really need to see that as serious.
And it mustn't be trustworthy with a question mark next to it, right?
No.
Okay.
No. It takes a long time to build trust, but about 30 seconds to lose it.
Right.
So, zero tolerance. The other is commitment. You know, some people join a board because they want that on a resume for a while. And wait a minute, should this be a long-term commitment? And what plans do you have for where you want the board to be 2 years from now, 3 years from now, 4 years from now? And I don't shy away from your developmental goals. I know that people join boards for the challenges that the board brings. But it also, you are a member of this board too, and you need to see the ownership of that, or the board needs to think seriously about asking you to leave. And I have asked board members to leave, you know, I mean, in a kind way, but it's like, you know, why don't I just ask you to send your resignation? Because it's clear that you're not with us here. You know, and I think a person should you know, be honest with themselves and step down to make room for another person. Managing people is not easy, you know. So commitment and ethics are high on that list. And my other, and this is personal to me, is I think you should be financially savvy. So much of the decisions that are made are financial based. In the nonprofit world, it's fund driven and budget driven. In the for-profit world, is profit driven, and along with that, liquidity and solvency and some of the other illities. And so the conversations are along there. I'm not saying that you have to be a CPA or CFA or CMA or any of those letters. I'm just saying that you need to understand business conversation, and business conversation is in many ways financial.
Now, where would people who want to be members of boards get that kind of training, if they don't have that?
Well, yeah, that's an interesting question. I get that from time to time. I don't really know if I know the answer to that. I mean, the obvious one is school. You know, you could go to various colleges and take various courses. There are various. I mean, I joined a foundation in San Francisco for public policy. I actually wrote a grant for my tuition, and then spending time with them.